I'm Duncan Foley, and this is the fourth class of advanced microeconomics information and behavior and political economy at the New School for Social Research. What I'm hoping to do today is to go over, do some review of the entropy-constrained behavior model so that we have as clear an idea of that as we can, and finish up the formal discussion of that. I think that will not take the whole class time. And then after a break, we'll start on the next lecture slides, which are about what I call the canonical social interaction model, which is the other major analytical tool that we'll be exploring in the rest of the course. As a review then, let me just go back to the entropy-constrained behavior model. We've done this a couple of times, but I don't think it hurts to do it again because it's so central to the thinking of the course. And it's a model, although it's rather simple, it's one of these simple things that has quite big ramifications and implications. So it doesn't hurt to spend another few minutes going over exactly what's going on here. The idea here has to do with introducing a little more behavioral realism into the model of choice. And the way that that works is that the usual model of choice says, well, you offer a decision maker some choices, and the decision maker has some payoff function over the choices. And the decision maker finds the choice that's available that has the highest payoff, and that's what she does. And that's the way, for example, typical economic choice theory, household demand theory, or profit maximization theory of the firm is set up. It turns out, however, that when you actually try to measure people or firms or any decision makers' behavior, that's not what happens. There's a good deal more variability in the behavior. And the reason for that, one reason you can think of for that is, if you're a physicist especially, that assuming that giving the decision maker exactly the same decision problem and assuming that you'll make always exactly the same decision is a little unlikely from a thermodynamic point of view. It's a little too predictable, and it doesn't allow for any kind of random fluctuations or random variation in behavior, even if there's a good deal of consistency in the behavior in a statistical sense over time or over a group of similar individuals. One way, as I say, not necessarily the only way, to introduce more realism in this thermodynamic sense into the economic behavior model is to constrain the individual's mixed strategy frequency distribution over the action set to have some minimal informational entropy. And the formalism of this we've gone over a couple of times. Expected payoff. We have a frequency that we assign to each of the actions that are available. These are the actions X, and a payoff for each of the actions. And the expected payoff is just the expectation of the payoffs given that frequency distribution. That's the ordinary, often called expected utility theory, except I'm trying to stay away from the word utility because it has implications that are a good deal broader than we need for this particular discussion. And now we're going to put a constraint on the frequencies, which is that the informational entropy of the frequency, which is the negative of the expectation of the log of the frequencies, that's the Shannon entropy that we introduced earlier in the course, should be not fall below some minimal level. And just to remind you again, and I strongly, I think there are some problems to try to encourage you to sit down and actually do the horrible task of working this out, but working it out, once you've worked it out once or twice, it works very well, and you'll see exactly what's going on and how you derive the resulting frequency distribution. But it's a very well-defined mathematical programming problem in terms of the frequencies, because the objective function is linear in the frequencies, since the payoffs are given, so they don't change. They're just like coefficients that multiply the frequencies. And the entropy is a strictly concave function, and therefore a constraint of this kind defines a strictly convex set. And so you know, first of all, that the solution to this problem is unique, and that the first order conditions are both necessary and sufficient to characterize that solution. Very, very well behaved problem. And one way to approach it is, in fact, to derive the first order conditions by setting up a Lagrangian. So in the Lagrangian, you have the expected utility plus a Lagrange multiplier, which we'll call capital T, that multiplies this entropy constraint. Now, I'd like you to just look at this a little bit more, because we haven't talked about this in quite the terms I'm about to so far. This part that says T times H min, of course, is a constant, so it doesn't have any influence on the frequency, so you just forget about it. The other part, what is the other part? The other part is the expected payoff, and then the Lagrange multiplier, the behavior temperature, times the entropy. So what this is basically telling you to do is to maximize a weighted sum of the expected payoff and the entropy. The bigger is the T, the more you're supposed to put an emphasis on maximizing entropy, and therefore the higher the entropy will be. But it's always going to be the case that the higher you make the entropy, the lower your expected utility is going to be. Why is that? Say loudly, Jose, do we have a hand around microphone? Jose is going to answer the question here.
Yep. Your behavior is more random?
Exactly. And as so Jose says the reason that your expected utility goes down is because your behavior is more random. And in particular, you're going to put a smaller weight on the high payoff actions. You're spreading the, because we know, for example, if T is zero, what are you going to do? What frequency distribution would you choose if T is zero, so you don't put any weight on the entropy at all? You would put all the weight on the one, or maybe there's some ties, but anyway, on the set of actions that give the highest payoff. Exactly. So you can see that as T gets bigger, it pulls down the expected utility because this, it pulls you towards this weighted average. And if you are doing this as a Lagrange problem, what you're going to do is adjust T until this constraint is just satisfied. So T, we've discussed sometimes in the earlier classes, just what determines the behavior temperature. Well, in a formal sense, what determines the behavior temperature is this minimum entropy level. Unfortunately, that's not always very helpful because we don't have any very good answer to the question, what determines the minimum entropy level? But at least we can see that there is a kind of duality between the behavior temperature and the minimum entropy level. And the higher the behavior temperature, the higher the minimum entropy level is going to be, and therefore the more you're going to spread out the action, and the less you're going to concentrate it on the payoff maximizing actions. This kind of thing is going to come up over and over again in the models in this course. Weighted average, where you have to explicitly trade off one goal against another, and the trade-off is parameterized by a weight like this behavior temperature. Okay, does anybody have any question about this setup or how it works? Daniel?
Could we consider the parameter T, the temperature, as some parameter measuring the sensibility of the constraints on the model? Because the function U is already being constrained by some other restrictions, right, in the model.
Well, it's the model. I mean, the payoff function is the structure. And we'll see that very clearly when we do things like profit rate equalization in the classical political economy or Marxist model. And it's the payoff is the model. It's what drives the explanatory power. Well, the envelope theorem does apply, just as it applies to any Lagrangian setup of this kind. So T also measures the increase in expected utility or expected payoff that you could get if you were allowed to go to a slightly lower entropy. I think that may be the sort of idea that you were going for. And it is just like every other envelope theorem. The Lagrange multiplier tells you the sensitivity of the objective function to the constraint level. Yes. Okay, so that is, let me now move to the next lecture, which we already did about a third of or a little bit more, which is to look at some applications of this entropy-constrained model in some more detail. And I told you the story, which I'm not going to repeat because we went over it in last class, of the expected utility theorem of the Neumann and Morgenstern and of the attempt of psychologists and experimental economists to measure the Neumann-Morgenstern utility through an experiment of a very specific kind. Now, this experiment itself is going to come up over and over again in this course, so you want to focus on it because it turns out to be a kind of a experiment. The experiment is that you have a subject who is supposed to be making a decision, and the subject has three outcomes, A, B, and C. And this, you know, this could be money, so it could be sums of money. If you're a bond trader, it is sums of money, for example. But we'll come back to the bond traders also after a little bit. And we know the way this is set up is that the payoff, the subject regards A as having a higher payoff than B, which has a higher payoff than C. The experimenter then sets up a lottery where A comes up with a frequency F and C comes up with a frequency 1 minus F. And the idea is to ask the subject, would you prefer to take the lottery or would you prefer to take the certain prospect of B? So if you think about this in terms of money, it says, well, the B is how much money is the equivalent of the uncertain outcome that is represented by the lottery. If you're a bond trader, a bond is basically maybe a pretty complicated lottery, but it's a bunch of monetary outcomes that you maybe can evaluate as a lottery. You know what the probability the bond's going to default is going to be, and a number of other things. And that creates a lottery in the bond. And then you want to know the price of the bond. Well, the price you're willing to pay, according to the Neumann and Morgenstern, is the money that's the equivalent. of the bond, of the lottery that represents the bond. So we can visualize this in a graph of this type. Here on the horizontal axis is the frequency of the good payoff, the A payoff, the preferred outcome. And on the vertical axis is the probability that the subject will take the lottery, will choose the lottery. So if the frequency of the good payoff is very low, for example, let's say the frequency of the good payoff is zero, you're never going to get the good payoff. You're always just going to get the bad payoff. Obviously, you prefer the B, right? Because B is better than C. And at the other end, if the frequency of the good payoff is very high, say it's one, you know you're going to get the good payoff, then you would always take the lottery because its payoff is, its expected payoff is higher than B. And somewhere in between, according to the von Neumann-Morgenstern axioms, there is a critical frequency level at which you just tip from suddenly from not taking the lottery to taking the lottery. If we change the utility of the good outcome and hold the utility of the bad, or the payoff of the bad outcome and of the certain equivalent constant, you can see what happens is that the better the good outcome is, the lower the frequency at which you would tip over. And the worse the good outcome is, the higher the frequency is at which you would tip over. But you always have this sharp step function, or what physicists call heavy side function, is implied by the von Neumann-Morgenstern theorem of expected utility. Does anybody have any question about this setup? Because this is going to come up over and over again. As been.
It's just a clarifying question. The subjects doing the lottery, what do they know about F, or what do they don't? Like, is it trial or error?
Okay, that's a very good question. The von Neumann-Morgenstern theorem assumes that the subject has an opinion about F. Von Neumann-Morgenstern don't tell you exactly how the subject gets the opinion about F. It might be that F is, they can see a mechanism generating F, like there's a big spinner, and one third of the spinner is red, and one third is, two thirds is another color, and you spin the spinner, and if it comes up in the red, you get the good prize, and if it comes in the other, you get the bad. So in that case, you might have a sort of mechanistic notion of the probability, or it may be that you're judging the probabilities as a Bayesian, and that you have some prior, and you have some information, and the F is what you guess, what you, your best estimate of the frequency with which you're going to see the different outcomes. So the important thing for von Neumann-Morgenstern is that the subject believes the frequencies. Okay. And if that's the assumption of the von Neumann-Morgenstern part. If you're doing this in a lab, in an experimental economics or psychology lab, clearly one of the experimental issues is how sure are you that the subjects know what's going on? So they will take a lot of trouble, and psychologists are very good at this because they've been burned very often by being sloppy about this and getting wrong results because the subject doesn't really understand what the question is or something like that. So they will try very hard to explain exactly what's going to happen. Anybody else have a question? Okay, when the early psychologists like Duncan Luce, Supes, Patrick Supes, and their associates started working with actual subjects, they found that this never turned out to happen. What always turned out was, and I'll just repeat this, I know I said it before, but it's so important, and we're going to see it over and over again. I want you to be sure to recognize it when you see it again. What actually happens is that when the frequency of the good prize is low, sure enough, the subject almost never takes the lottery, just like the von Neumann Morgenstern prediction. And when the frequency of the good prize is high, the subject almost always takes the lottery, just like von Neumann Morgenstern. So Kyle, you've been asking, is, you know, what's the relation of this to utility or payoff maximization? So it certainly has an element of payoff maximization in it, because in these extremes, the subject acts just the same way as the expected payoff maximizer. But in between, there's a range where the subject sometimes takes the lottery and sometimes doesn't take the lottery. And the frequency with which the subject takes the lottery, the probability of taking the lottery, gradually increases with this type of shape, this kind of S-curve shape. In fact, Duncan Luce figured out exactly what that shape was mathematically. And you can reproduce this mathematically yourself if you get subjects to do it. You'll see that how it works. Okay, and we've seen that this is exactly what you would expect if the subject is behaving according to the entropy-constrained model at a non-zero behavior temperature. If the behavior temperature gets higher, the precision with which the subject can make the choice diminishes, the S-curve gets flatter, there's more apparent intransitivity. Because in this intervening period, in this intervening interval, it looks like the subject is not being consistent. Sometimes she takes the lottery, sometimes she doesn't take the lottery when you give exactly the same stimulus, which is not what's supposed to happen with transitive preferences, right? With transitive preferences, the subject is always supposed to know which one she prefers and always make the same decision. But that's exactly what does not happen. When the decision temperature is lower, the precision with which the subject can discriminate is much sharper. And we'll see some, I think, rather amusing examples of this in a moment. The whole thing looks like the von Neumann-Morgenstern story as the payoff of the good prize varies. It moves this whole process left and right in this diagram. But it doesn't change the actual shape of this curve, which is called the logit quantal response curve, and it is the Gibbs response, quantal response, that we have in the entropy constraint model. Does anybody have any question? This is our last path. Well, it's not the last. We can go back to any of these things, but this is the last planned pass at reviewing this basic background material. So I want to make sure everybody feels comfortable that they know what's going on. If you can possibly stand it, I really urge you to set up, get together in four or five and do some experiments with each other and see what happens. You don't have to use money, even though it's an economics curriculum. If we're in business school, they would use money. That's on to the liar's poker, which we'll get to in a moment. And then we talked some about the history of the logit quantal response, that Luce thought that the explanation for this was actually that the subjects didn't know their own payoff functions too accurately. And he derived it on he derived a whole theory of this, which is a very influential theory in psychology and to some degree in finance on the basis of that. But we can see that it's exactly equivalent to entropy constraint, to the entropy constraint, and the key parameter that controls how steep this function is, how sharp the function is the behavior temperature. I like to think of decision makers as information channels. And in a stimulus response kind of setting, which is like psychology. In this case, the stimulus is the action set. What are your choices? And your response is what you're observed to do when you're confronted with this action set, which is going to be a quantal, in general, is going to be a quantal response. Or it turns out in almost every experiment that people do, it is a quantal response. The tendency of the responses to cluster statistically, they're clearly not random, right? Because if you get the lottery really bad, they always won't take it. And if you make it really good, they'll always take it, or almost always take it. But in between, sometimes the subjects take it and sometimes they don't take it. Use intuition or self-inspection, internal inspection, and say, how do I make decisions of this kind? And are there decisions where I'm kind of on the edge, and sometimes I would go one way and sometimes I would go the other way? One hopes that those decisions, for example, are not decisions that are involved in avoiding an automobile accident or something of that kind. The automobile accident, you really want to decide whether you're going to turn left or right. Of course, you also get into the coordination problem that if the person you're about to run into, driver you're about to run into, is a little uncertain, then you can have the bad outcome where you both go the same direction and the collision occurs. The tendency of the responses to clusters statistically reflects some kind of learned or evolved behavior, which we represent in economics by these payoff functions, the notion that the certain actions are connected with certain rewards or certain payoffs. And the residual variance of observed behavior is due to the limited bandwidth the organism can deploy to process the information into a behavioral response. And the bandwidth is parameterized either by an explicit entropy constraint or because we usually can't observe the entropy constraint directly by the Lagrange multiplier, the behavior temperature, which is just another way of parameterizing the same trade-off. Now, you can actually develop quite a bit of theory about this. And I would encourage you, if you're working on real data, and working on real data is immensely helpful in this area, to try to get the data in this general form, where you're actually seeing how often an individual does one thing or another. Or maybe you have you have observations on a lot of individuals who are not identical, but maybe in respect to this particular decision you're looking at, they're very similar. So you can take the proportion of them that do one thing and the proportion of them that do another thing as the equivalent of the quantal response probability. It's very helpful to work with data in this respect. But let's look at some simple models. The simplest utility that's widely used is a quadratic utility. So you say, okay, the action will measure it in some arbitrary way so that the best thing you can do is x equals zero. If you go either x above zero or x below zero, it's not as good. And how much it's not as good is measured by a quadratic. So the payoff function is a parabola with its nose at the zero point. You're saturated when x equals zero, okay, and you have the marginal utility is just linear in the action, and it depends on which direction you're going, whether the marginal utility is positive or negative because of the symmetry of the situation. Well, what is the Gibbs distribution corresponding to a quadratic utility function? It's e to the minus x squared over 2t, right? Because x squared over 2t, x squared over 2 is the payoff. The Gibbs function is always proportional to the payoff divided by t, e to the payoff divided by t. We saw that as a general theorem in solving the entropy-constrained behavior model. And then these constants, the square root of 2 pi and the square root of t, are what's required to normalize this function, that is, make its integral over the whole range of behavior from minus infinity to plus infinity equal to exactly 1, so that you get a well-defined probability distribution. Well, this is a very familiar probability distribution. It's the one we see and use all the time. In fact, you're practically required by the econometrics rulebook to focus a lot of attention on this probability distribution. I'm going to try, it's like pulling teeth, to persuade you to distrust this probability distribution, despite the fact that everybody believes in it, and look for other possibilities, which we'll see in a moment. Well, one immediate example is that when you have this quadratic utility function, we're implicitly assuming that the action set is any number between minus infinity and plus infinity, right? Any real number. You can do anything you want. You're not going to do very big positive or big negative actions, right? Why not? Because the payoff is very low, right? Because the payoff's going down is x squared. So as x gets big in the positive direction or in the negative direction, the payoff falls off very rapidly. Does the probability or the frequency with which you will do an action ever get to zero? No. You know that the Gaussian normal probability distribution asymptotically goes to zero for x getting very big, but it never actually cuts off and says, no, you won't go above a certain level. There's always a little probability of very, very big deviations from the mean. But here in many economic decisions, for example, liquidity management. What's the big issue with liquidity management? Big issue with liquidity management is not running out of money. So your decisions typically, the payoff to your decisions often has something to do with how much money the decision leaves you with. And there's a lower bound on the individual's actions. So you're not allowed to have negative amounts of money, let's say, or to spend so much that you spend all of your money plus some more. Well, the unconstrained action distribution may be normal if the payoff function is quadratic. We could keep that that way. But a lower bound constraint can dramatically change the behavioral distribution. So here is x min. So we're now going to say the decision maker is not allowed to choose an x below this value x min, which I've initially set to minus 10. It's probably hard to see on the screen, but that's what the current one is. Well, look what happens if I raise that. Minimum. So now the minimum is, say, 1.75. Now, are you ever going to see the individual go below 1.75? No, because that's constrained. They're constrained away from it. They would want to go to less than 1.75 sometimes, but the constraint is set up that they can't do it. They have to, it's a bank, and they have to have some minimum reserve balance at the Fed, or you have to keep some minimum balance in your checking account or something of that kind. Remind me again, it's Brad. Yep.
It's Brad, actually. Uh-huh. This sort of appears like Brad. Yep. If you have a truncated prior or a heavy side prior, and then you make a posterior distribution after it, and like the graph is completely cut off at zero, is that just a mathematical curiosity, or is there some intuitive relationship?
Well, if the constraint really is zero, let's go try and make this. Suppose, well, look at something like this. Okay. I think what's important here is to distinguish, because the idea of a constraint is very important in the modeling that we're going to do. A constraint is very different from this quantal response kind of smearing out of the behavior. So you get the smearing out here, all right, but there's just one part of the decision space that's excluded. Typically, it's excluded by institutions, let's say social institutions. For example, that you're not allowed to run out of money, or people won't give you credit, or that you can't print your own money, or something of that kind. I don't know if that answered your question exactly, but okay. You could ask it again later if you want, and maybe you'll get a better answer. Okay, so this, now look at this, let's look at an error distribution like this. So if this is the kind of behavior that you're watching, you're seeing a decision maker with a quadratic, very ordinary utility, but subject to a lower bound on the action, then the probability distribution, the frequency with which you see the agent take these different actions, is going to be this quite skewed, truncated, normal distribution. If that's what you're dealing with and you're running linear regressions, you're missing the boat. Because linear regression basically is assuming that the errors are symmetrical, right? And if they're not symmetrical, then that's a very important piece of information about the system that you're studying. Actually, you can calculate the mean and the median of these entropy-constrained distributions, particularly for the quadratic utility. And I just put them in here because Mathematica can do it, so it shows off Mathematica. This thing called ERFC is the error function. It's just e to the minus x squared. And the inverse error function is the inverse of that. And Mathematica can compute all these things. So if you want to know what the median behavior or the mean behavior of a decision maker who's maximizing quadratic utility subject to a lower bound constraint, there it is. You can find that out. And you're not going to estimate that with linear regression. Okay, so let's continue. Here's an example, another example from demand theory. Simplest demand theory. This model came out of this work I was doing with Sam Bowles and Simon Halliday on converting Bowles's microeconomics book into an intermediate theory textbook. And I was looking, since I was teaching it at Lang College, where many of the students don't have calculus, and some do, but it's not universal. I was looking for a very, very simple model of demand behavior, namely linear demand function. Well, the linear demand function arises from a quadratic payoff function. And here's the payoff function. U depends on X, which is the amount of the good that you buy, and Y, which is the amount of money you have left over after you've paid for the good. So those are the, so just the two-dimensional trade-off kind of problem. And the payoff function is, first of all, linear in Y. So you always like more money. And the amount of how much you like money doesn't ever change. In fact, money is kind of a metric for payoff in this case, in these quasi-linear cases. And we deduct what? Minus one-half a ratio R max over X max times the difference between X and X max squared, which is a quadratic. In fact, this is just a generalization of the quadratic we were looking at before, except instead of centering at zero, we're centering it at X max. X max is the bliss point or saturation. When you get up to X max of the good, you don't want any more. That's the maximum you want. R max turns out to be the maximum, the money that you will pay for one unit of the good when you don't have any of it, when you start with X equals zero. So it's the vertical intercept of the demand function, and X max is the horizontal intercept. And this ratio, R max over X max, is the slope of the demand function. And it's not hard to see that if you substitute for y, which is w, the amount of money you start with, minus p, the price of the good, times x, the amount that you buy, so the amount you have left over is just what you started with minus what you spent on the good, you find this, this expression for the, you can expand this into this expression for the payoff, and it's not hard to see that it's maximized when x is equal to x max times 1 minus p over r max. So you compare the price to the maximum price you would pay, and you buy a proportion of your maximal demand that depends on how far, how low the price is. When the price goes down to zero, you buy your maximal amount. It's just a plain old linear demand. You'll notice, incidentally, that this is actually has the same form as the temperature trade-off. For example, W doesn't change here, right? So what are you really trading off? As you get more X, you're reducing this penalty payoff, right? But you're increasing the amount of money you have to spend. So this is very much like the sum of the expected payoff and the temperature-weighted entropy that we saw before, except now what you're trading off is money left over against the payoff that you get from consuming this good. So we know it's maximized this way. But if we are now in the world of entropy-constrained behavior, what we know is that the individual will not always buy exactly this amount of X when she confronts the price P. Why not? Which is what you were supposed to have been taught in intermediate microeconomic theory, right? That maximize payoff or subject to the budget constraint, and you get the demand point, which is, just the demand, x. Why in the world of entropy-constrained behavior is this wrong?
It assumes that they can do that with absolute precision.
Exactly. And they will do it every time. You give them exactly the same price and exactly the same income, and they're going to come out of the store with exactly the same amount of the good. But in entropy-constrained world, we don't believe that would be a behavior temperature of zero. And we don't believe there's ever a behavior temperature of zero, because we can never demonstrate it experimentally, and probably we can't demonstrate it observationally. What do we believe? We believe, however, that the buyer here has some tendency to buy this amount of the good. That's the most likely amount of the good she's going to buy, right? And in fact, the frequency with which she'll buy any amount of the good is going to just be this expression, the demand, the deviation of that amount of good from the demand point, divided by the behavior temperature, T, and then the whole thing normalized by just integrating over all the levels, that you, all the different amounts of the good that you can buy, which goes from zero to Xmax, because you're never going to buy less than, you can't consume less than zero in this model, and you don't want to consume but more than Xmax, because at Xmax your marginal payoff for the good goes to zero, so you don't want it. But here's a perfectly interpretable frequency distribution to describe the behavior of an individual with this very simple quadratic payoff. It's actually a Gaussian normal distribution. So if you did a linear regression on this kind of data, it'll work. In other words, you change the price and you observe the amount that the individual buys, or maybe more likely you have a whole bunch of similar individuals and you change the price and you see what they all buy together, right? Or you are lucky enough to have individual data, so you see how much each of them buys. Well, it turns out that they don't all buy exactly the same amount. But because you're doing linear regression, you find that the average amount that they buy, the most likely amount, is in fact what you predict from this demand. And that their behavior then is scattered around that according to the Gaussian normal distribution, and you get your paper published, since that's what economics journals want to see, right? They want to see that intermediate micro is correct. Jose, let's get your voice for posterity here.
Okay. So, in this framework, then you would argue that when you're constructing or building demand curves, they are actually representing aggregate or average purchases by the aggregate individual or something like that.
So Jose says that means that when you do a demand curve with ordinary econometrics, I'm saying I would interpret it as one of two things. It's either the average behavior of an ensemble of similar purchasers that we're observing, like a cross section, or we're observing the same buyer doing the same problem over and over again, and we notice that when we do that, she doesn't always do exactly the same thing, and the amount by which she doesn't do the same thing in this model is exactly represented by the Gaussian distribution. Daniel.
Thinking about this in terms when we are observing data and we are trying to construct a model based on the maximum entropy principle. So according to this, there is a link between the way you are constructing the objective function with how the data is distributed, or the kind of shape or the family that you can infer from the data. So there will always be a connection between what you observe and the type of function that you can specify. Otherwise, there will be no matching between the two of them.
So Daniel says, I'm going to repeat just in case the audio is not clear. Daniel's saying exactly what I'm going to say on the next slide. So he has the satisfaction of figuring it out one slide ahead. What this means is that there is a very strong correspondence between the payoff function, which is motivating the individual, and not only the mean behavior, but the errors that you observe. It's not exactly your words, but that's what I, yes. That means that the errors have as much information in them as does the central tendency. So the errors are not noise from this point of view. They're not just errors in measurement, or like we talked last time about the astronomer sees the star jumping around. It's not just air currents up there that are distorting the light rays. But in fact, it's telling you something quite important about the behavior of the individual, namely both the payoffs and the behavior temperature. So we can visualize this distribution of demand. But you'll see that because this demand is truncated at zero and x max, what happens as the p changes? Well, if p is very low, you do not get a symmetrical error distribution, because the individual lands with very close to the x max, to her saturation level. As p rises, it starts looking more and more like a normal error distribution. But as p gets very big, once again, it's not, you're starting to hit the zero constraint a lot. If I change r max, the maximum amount that she's going to pay, that also changes the error distribution. Although then if I raise the price enough, I can get it back something like a normal, looking something like a normal. Change x max, change it. And above all, if I change t goes down and is very low, then not only does it look pretty much normal, it has a small sigma, has a small deviation. Whereas if t is big, in fact, if you get t big enough, there's hardly any information at all to be got out of this. I mean, you might have a very, very weak peak of the probability of the frequency at the demand point. And this is the slide that Daniel previewed for us. Econometric models, particularly linear regression models, tend to make strong arbitrary a priori assumptions about error distributions. without carefully grounding the assumptions in an analysis of the actual underlying behavior, and in particular of the constraints on the underlying behavior. So a typical demand model is going to assume that you're somehow operating sort of in this regime, right, where you've got a nice narrow error distribution around the mean behavior. The Gauss-Markov model is particularly striking in this respect because it assumes that you have IID, independent, identically distributed normal errors in the different observations, which, as we've seen, corresponds to a behavior around a quadratic payoff function, but only if you're not running into one or another constraint or boundary condition or something like that, which distorts it. We talked last time, I stole this part for myself, about the telescopes and Gauss, and so I'm not going to repeat that. But the end message of this discussion of Gauss and normal errors was, and the central limit theorem, was that it was motivated by a case where the variability of behavior had nothing to do, variability of observations had nothing to do with animal or human behavior. It had to do with the the cross currents in the jet stream and all that in the atmosphere, which is where you get the central limit theorem kind of reasoning. But there's a lot of reason to question the relevance of this highly successful model of perturbations for astronomical observations to the analysis of data generated by living organisms, such as human beings. Because the living organisms have learned what their payoff is, where they have to go to get food, where they have to go to mate, where they have to go to do all of their biological functions, and how to get their needs met. And it's those things that are structuring their behavior. But if their behavior is being modulated by an entropy constraint, then that's also modulating the fluctuations that you're going to observe in their behavior, either for an individual or for a collection of individuals, a cross-section of individuals who are essentially similar. Look, how bad is this? Well, this is pretty general. Why is it pretty general? Because any payoff function can be expanded as a Taylor series, right? Well, what is a Taylor series? It's got a constant term. Constant term makes no difference to quantal behavior, right? You add an A to the payoff function, it doesn't change the quantal distribution at all. You can set the linear part equal to zero, and what do you have? You have a quadratic. So embedded in pretty much any of these behavior situations, one way to look at them is that they are quadratics. And therefore that these constrained quadratic fluctuation models are actually pretty general. That part isn't so bad. What's the trouble with econometrics is that it it ignores the constraint part, and therefore ignores possible skewness and asymmetry in the error, what we call error distribution. But I think it's better to think of it as a fluctuation distribution, which is inherent in the behavior of organisms like human beings. Now, there are presumably classes of situations where the variation in individual behavior will not be normally distributed. One important class of situations in economics, as we've seen, is when the individual behavior is constrained in some way, like the minimum liquidity constraint, the minimum money, or in the demand model that we just looked at, where the individual never can buy less than zero or more than X max of the good. But there may be other ones, and this is unexplored territory, and so this is the kind of thing that you might want to be interested in. Suppose that the cubic or higher order terms of the payoff function are really pretty important. Then they may also be responsible for skewed distributions of behavior. You want to keep your eye open as to whether that's happening. Okay, let me finish up this set of slides with a little review of this wonderful book, which if you haven't read it, it's really funny and it's well worth reading. It's a book called Liar's Poker. It was the first book that this man, Michael Lewis, whose more recent book called The Big Short is made into a movie that's, I think, going the rounds of theaters right now. But in Liar's Poker, Lewis, who's a very idiosyncratic guy, he's a Princeton art history major who talked his way into being a trader at Salomon Brothers at a reception where the Queen of England was present, and he tells, it's a very funny story about that. But he's clearly a fish out of water, but he also is a very smart fish out of water, and he makes quite a career of this, both as a bond trader, and he made even more money writing this book about bond traders. In fact, the head of the Salomon Brothers at that time, John Gutfreund, after he published this book, said, "Michael, you've wrecked my whole career." Didn't make Gutfreund any less wealthy, but apparently it's made people treat him differently in a way that he didn't like. Well, what's the story of Liar's Poker? Well, it's the story of beginning neoliberalism, and it's about the early 1980s when bond traders at Salomon Brothers were suddenly able, and Michael Lewis explains, he says bond trading was, you know, a really boring business in the 60s and 70s for a particular reason, which was that the Fed was stabilizing interest rates like crazy. So bond prices were not fluctuating a whole lot. But in the 1980s, suddenly these bond traders on this floor at Salomon Brothers could siphon enormous sums of money from their customers, buying and selling bonds to them. And Lewis explains this as magical, he calls it a magical ability, because the bond traders didn't understand really why it was happening. They were just doing the same thing that they'd always been doing, but all of a sudden their incomes were 5 to 10 times higher than they had been 5 years before, which is a lot the story of advanced capitalist society in our era, right? Well, according to Lewis, the way this worked was there were two important factors. First, the bond traders had a much better idea of the price of any given bond in the current market than their customers. Second, deregulation of bond markets and banks and the shift of monetary policy to the Volcker shock free bond prices to become much more volatile. So as a result, price information became much more valuable. Now, let's think about this a little bit from the entropy-constrained point of view. Pricing a bond is very abstractly very much like the loose Supes experiments, the Neumann Morgenstern experiment, right? Pricing a bond is how much actual money, cash money today, is the equivalent of this lottery that the bond represents in terms of its default probability and interest rate risk and all of these other things. So that's That's really pretty much exactly the same experiment. So one way to understand this bond market example is that the bond traders were operating at a much lower behavior temperature than their customers. If you think about it in terms of the quantum response, the bond traders had a very sharp, relatively sharp quantum response, and the customers had a very shallow quantum response. Now that doesn't mean that the bond customers are dumb. If you get to the extremes, the bond customers are always going to make the right call, right? When the bond is way underpriced or the bond is way overpriced, they're going to know it. But in an important range in between, the customer is going to be acting almost at random because their quantum response is going to be almost flat. Meanwhile, the bond traders is doing much better in that range as far as deciding whether the bond is worth a certain amount. So what this is telling me is that differences in behavior temperature in financial and financial asset markets, like stock markets, can be extremely important because it's not that there are noise traders or dumb traders or, you know, random traders, but a high temperature trader can look like a noise trader to a low temperature trader. And therefore what we're often seeing in these models of financial markets that is called noise trading, it's just an approximation to relatively high temperature traders. Okay, so that is my end of this lecture, so we'll take a break. This is called social interaction, and this is the other main intellectual or modeling tool that I want to introduce to you. It's a particular kind a way of looking at not every, but a wide class. It's quite amazing how wide a class of economic phenomena this model can be used to illuminate. Let's back up a little bit and ask ourselves just what is social science? I think social science, to answer what social science is, you have to answer what it means to say behavior is social. I'd argue that the specifically social aspect of behavior arises when the presence of other people in an interaction has an effect on individual behavior. And this is the idea of this canonical social interaction model. We might, however, contrast it a little bit with supply and demand or with general equilibrium models, because it's curiously the property of supply and demand and general equilibrium models to try to insulate the individuals from any social interaction. The individual in a competitive market is not supposed to care what the other individuals are doing. All she cares about is the price she has to pay. Therefore, economics, although it calls itself the queen of the social sciences sometimes, which is a phrase that makes me a little uncomfortable, in a curious sense is trying not to be, it's trying to not be a social science from this point of view, because it's trying to suppress the social dimension of the interactions that make a system characteristically social. The social interaction model does not have that limitation, and that's one reason it's quite interesting. I would like to encourage people to replace the supply and demand model with this social interaction model. It's like this Leon Hufu joke about the when he did the quasi-anthropology of the economists, he said the economists are divided into two tribes, the macro and the micro. And the totem of the micro is two crossed lines like that. And the totem of the macro is two crossed lines like that, by which he meant the ISLM, so supply and demand in ISLM. So it turns out the social interaction model is also two crossed lines, but how much do you want from the amount you're paying the new school? Okay. Here is the canonical social interaction model. It's very simple to describe, but it has a lot of subtlety to it and its application in specific examples. Most of the rest of the course, I'm going to try to walk through applications. First, applications from classical political economy, Smith, and then some from Marx's political economy, and then Keynes. And I believe that this same gadget, as it were, can throw light on all of these heterodox approaches to economics. And that's what I'm going to try to persuade you of over the next few weeks. But here it is, it's really simple. So we start off with a large number, we'll call it capital N. We'll distinguish them as I goes from 1 to N. Of identical individuals. This identicalness can be relaxed, and we will talk some about how it can be relaxed. But for the moment, and this is an uncomfortable moment because it sounds much like the representative agent, which the much maligned representative agent. Well, first of all, it's not a representative agent, as we'll see. Because of the specific way the model is set up. But it does share with the representative agent idea the notion of maximizing the leverage you get out of a certain kind of symmetry, out of assuming a certain kind of symmetry. As I say, we can relax that symmetry, but it's amazing how far you can go even maintaining the symmetrical assumption. Each of them controls some action, which we'll call X. So the action that the individual takes is XI. This is same thing as we were talking about before, the action set, okay? They all have the same action set. And typically the action set is going to be a number. You could think of as the amount that you buy of something or the amount of a public good that you produce, or the number of cows that you graze on the common, or the probability that you adopt a certain mode of behavior, that you cooperate with certain institutions, or that you behave according to certain institutional expectations. It's possible, and we'll talk a little bit about treating X as a vector, that is completely in the spirit of the model, and from a formal point of view, there's nothing wrong with it. It leads to much more complicated mathematics. And in this first course, I don't want to necessarily get into that because you can get a lot of the feel for it. But if you're interested in more sophisticated models and phenomena that can only be explained by assuming that the action space is multidimensional, let's go for it. I mean, it's a terrific thing, but I would walk before you run and get the one-dimensional, get a pretty good feel for the one-dimensional version of the model first. We'll call boldface X the vector of the actions of the individual. So the state of this little society is just what everybody's doing. How much each individual is doing of this behavior X. We're going to call the nth individual who's identical, so it really doesn't matter whether you pick the nth individual or the first individual or the fifth individual or whoever it is, just one, but we'll pick the nth one. We'll call that nth individual the typical individual. So a lot of the drama of this has to do with thinking about the situation of the typical individual. So you want to get that idea. The typical individual is one out of the crowd. It's a face in the crowd, a particular face in this crowd. And we're going to let the average level of this action X across the other individuals be called Z. So Z is the average of what everybody else is doing. Now, in particular, if everybody else is doing exactly the same thing, then Z is what everybody else is doing. And that's a case that is often very helpful to think through, and it is a lot simpler than some of the other cases. And the notation we'll use for Z is that it's X bar, that is the average of X, or the physicists like this notation where they put these little brackets around X to mean the expectation or the average level of some variable X. And it's 1 over n minus 1 times the sum of the X's up through n minus 1, because we're not going to include the typical individual in the average, since she is outside the average. She's the one we're separating out. The idea of a social interaction comes from making the perceived payoff of each agent, all of them identical, depend on her own action, X, and on the average action of everybody else in the society. Very simple idea. So the payoff of the typical individual, which is the same for everybody, depends on what she does, XI, and what everybody else is doing, or the average of what everybody else is doing. This moment. And we're going to assume that there is a best response. That is, that there is a highest payoff action for the individual, conditional on what everybody else does. May change when what everybody else does changes, and that's going to be a key part of these models. But for any description of what everybody else is doing, there's a best response for the individual, for the typical individual. You could introduce different kinds of heterogeneity by having another property or characteristic for the individuals, which we might call Y. But at the moment, as I say, to keep things as simple and clean as possible, I'm just going to assume they're all the same. And so they don't, and they all react in exactly the same way when they're in the symmetrical position, which is the key to the whole simplicity of this, and also its very considerable explanatory power. Physicists would call this a mean field theory because of the assumption that the behavior of any individual depends on the average of what everybody else is doing. And mean field theories are actually quite common in physics, and they're a very powerful tool of analysis, but they're not the only way to think about complex interactive systems. I just mentioned that in other applications, depending on what problem you're working on, it might make more sense to use another summary statistic, like the median. What's the median of the rest of the society doing if they're not all doing the same thing? If they're all doing the same thing, it doesn't really matter much what statistic we take, because all the statistics, median and the mode and the mean, are all going to be exactly the same, but could be different. Oriel, do you have the... speak up, because everybody has to hear you.
By using like a mean field and an approximation, one can also use instead, for example, like introduce like social structure, right? Like, for example, rather than like relating to Z, the average, you can also relate to, I don't know, like the X values of your neighbor, social neighbors, with certain
Yes, you get much more complicated. Okay, so Oriel says, could the dependence in principle be more complicated? For example, maybe there's some topology here. So the all the individuals, some are more connected to others. You have the degrees of separation or some kind of graph theory. And maybe what you respond to is much more what people close to you or what the other individuals close to you are doing, not the average over the whole field. Yes. And that's a great idea, and it might be necessary to answer some problems, but I wouldn't assume, I would try as hard as you could not to make an assumption like that until you were absolutely, the problem absolutely had you in a hammer lock and on the mat, and the only way you can get out is to introduce that complication. We'll see, you can go a long way, you can go a long way with this. Well, let's think about what this kind of system looks like. Individual behavior, when the individual takes others' behavior as given, is a best response. This is the Nash assumption, the Nash equilibrium assumption. That means that this model is a very rather special case of Nash equilibrium. And it has shares with Nash and a very important other thinker in this respect is Cournot, the original Cournot model, which is of this type. That's one reason why Cournot is so important. The individual's best response, taking z as given, is the solution, which we'll call x of z. That's the best response. X is the best thing you can do when everybody else is doing z. And how do you find that? Well, you maximize your payoff over your behavior x holding constant z, because you assume everybody is going to do the same thing. This is a very enormous simplification theoretically, which is going to be of immense help to us. It allows you to do what appear to be almost impossibly complex problems fall apart because of this ability to think about it in terms of the best response. Because all the individuals are identical in the relevant aspects, the relevant social interaction aspects, the equilibrium individual level of the action has to be a best response to itself. In other words, what we mean by an equilibrium is a level of the individual action such that if everybody adopts it, everybody is making their best response to what everybody else is doing. That is Nash, that is a particular case of Nash equilibrium. In other words, you can write this that X, the condition for equilibrium XE, is that the best response to XE, when everybody else is doing XE, your best response is do XE. If your best response is different, then XE can't be in equilibrium. And this is a key part, and it makes working out these problems, as I say, in what appear to be impossibly complex situations, it suddenly simplifies and makes transparent the logic behind complex social interactions. In some cases, we're going to assume that there's a stimulus or a policy contribution to the social action. So perhaps the social action is, let's say we're in Keynesian economics, the social action is how much you spent, which depends on how much other people spend. Why does it depend on how much other people spend? Because your income depends on how much other people spend, right? Now, it might be that there's another source of spending besides the private sector. Let's say a government or a rest of the world exports or something like that. We'll call that xi sometimes. And in that case, the equilibrium condition is slightly changed. It says, okay, XE has the property that when the individual sees XE plus this social contribution or this stimulus element, then her best response is XE. But you can see then that the equilibrium is going to depend on the level of the social stimulus or the social contribution. I'm going to ask you this question some more times, but this is a good first time to ask it. Does anybody have any question about this definition of equilibrium and best response that I can clarify at this moment? I don't believe it, but I will go forward nonetheless. Here's the Mathematica code to compute a best response. And here's a particular quadratic payoff function, which looks like the following. X is the individual's action. The payoff to X is two components. One is an individual component, alpha. That's what you get for doing the action. But then there's another component which depends on what other people are doing, which we'll call beta times z. It's just all linear. And then we're going to subtract off 1/2 x squared because, it, say, it costs you some effort or something to do the action, so you want to do that. And then maybe you get some benefit just purely as an externality from what everybody else does, gamma times z. It's important to realize, however, that that kind of simple additive externality has no impact on your best response. It's just a gift from the society, because it doesn't change when you change your action x. On the other hand, this part of it, this beta part of it, does depend on your action x. Well, the unconstrained best response for an individual with this quadratic payoff is, in fact, to set the best response x equal to alpha plus beta times z. You can figure that out by differentiating this payoff function and setting the derivative equal to 0. And the 1/2 is in there so that when you differentiate, 2 comes down and it cancels out with the 1/2. So you have minus x plus alpha plus z, beta z is equal to 0, which means the best response x is just alpha plus beta z, linear. It's amazing how far you can go with this, although we'll modify this in some important ways. It might be, and it often is, very interesting to consider cases where the individual action is constrained by upper and lower bounds, so that you can't keep going to lower and lower x's, you have to stop, maybe at x equals 0, for example, like the money thing that we talked about. And maybe there's an upper bound. You can go bigger and bigger, but sooner or later you just can't make your x any bigger as an individual. This type of bound is particularly relevant when the x is the probability that you're going to do some action, because the probability can't be lower than 0 and it can't be bigger than 1. So in cases where we're going to think of the individual's best response as a probability, that is the relationship. I will just show you this very quickly. So here is the picture. Z is going across the horizontal axis. That's what everybody else is doing. X is going on the vertical axis. That's what you're doing. The blue line is the 45-degree line. So that's the equilibrium where you're doing the same thing. Everybody's doing the same thing. The red line is the best response. In this case, the best response a beta is positive, so the best response increases as other people do the thing. But beta is less than 1, so the slope is less than the 45 degree when it cuts it. So this is stable, as it were. If everybody else did a little less of the action, you do some less, but you're still doing more than everybody else. So tend to go back towards the equilibrium. And this green point is the social coordination solution, which is what you would choose if you got to choose both x and z. Right? We'll come back to that next week. Now, I just want to show you one last image to stay with you for the rest of the week. Suppose beta gets bigger than 1. Okay, so now we have really strong social interaction. The more everybody else is doing the thing, you really like to do it a lot more. In fact, so much more that this intersection here is unstable. If everybody else does more of it, you increase, but you increase by more than they do. So you're going to drive the thing farther away, and the only possibility here is that you're going to land at the one extreme or the other extreme. This is often called the assurance and assurance game in the other ones where beta is less than 1 are prisoner's dilemmas. So we will stop at that point and pick up from this next week.